I had this dream one night, and it was a seahorse. I was riding a seahorse through the water in a wave, and I was on a hoop. And I knew I had to move forward. What was it going to be? I think it was that pressure that opened my mind and my heart to what it was that we were going to do next. That's when the seahorse really came into my life as far as, we're going to do this. The seahorse is such a magical part of the coral reef. You know, I think it's easy to connect with the seahorse. If you ever see one, it just becomes part of your heart. So I realized that people would want to have a seahorse as a pet, and that people would be enchanted with the animal, so much so that they would be connected to the ocean. And they would start to think about where the animal came from, about where the animal lives, and about the health of the ocean.
They originally were seahorses found in Hilo Bay, Kailua Bay, Waikiki, those kind of more quieter areas. And they are gone today, very, very rare. And that is mainly because of the pet trade. In Hawaii, the pet trade collects between 2 and 10 million fish per year of our reefs for pets.
Today we're under siege by the collectors. So if this upsets you like it upsets me, please write a letter to our governor and complain. Just go straight to the top.
Americans have to, we've got to get on board. So that's what we're trying to do, is get people interested in what's underneath the water. Not just come to Hawaii and have a Mai Tai on the beach, but get under the water.
So what's wrong with Hawaii? We're kind of in the dark ages. Yeah, we're not restricting the permits. We're letting anybody buy them and take as many as they want.
In the state of Hawaii, they actually don't even protect the seahorse, even though it's an endangered species. And 175 countries actually protect the seahorse.
There's a lot of people here in Hawaii that are, you know, very concerned about ocean conservation. But are they willing to, you know, stand up and pass a law that says you can't take, you know, marine fish off our reefs anymore? Are they willing to stand up and say, let's make this a national monument, let's, you know, protect our Hawaiian reefs?
I can tell you the very first time I ever saw a seahorse was one that was washed up in front of our house in Costa Rica. And one of the employees of the shrimp hatchery found this seahorse, and we decided to put it into my boss's aquarium. Because we had that seahorse, you know how things prompt your mind, and that's what really started our interest in seahorses. We started to think, you know, what could we possibly do? What could we do to help these guys out?
We were the first people to close the life cycle on the seahorse and breed the animal in captivity without going to the wild to get pregnant males. We were the first seahorse farm in the world. When I went to research the seahorses, the story came to be about the medicine trade, about them being almost an endangered species, becoming extinct because of the other factors too, which included pollution and the pet trade. And when I saw that they were a big part of the pet trade, I knew we had something. I knew we could do something about it, and I thought, this is it, because I can get this farm-raised seahorse into the pet trade and start to change the way people think.
We love seahorses.
Good.
We have 40, 50,000 people a year coming through here, and they want help. So, you know, we have an audience already.
That's Rosie. I'm a Lucan cockatoo that's saying good morning to all of us. Now, the type of zooplankton that the seahorses like to eat is called a copepod. Now, what do you think is going on with copepods out there in the ocean? Their population is declining. Anybody have any ideas why?
It makes us feel good. You know, we're happy when we go home. You know, we feel like we did something. We don't have a lot of money in the bank, but we feel good inside.
Should we feed them? Okay, go ahead and pour the red shrimp into the water in front of you. Okay, you'll see their eyes are rotating independently, allowing them to see in two different directions at the same time. This allows them to see a potential prey, like a shrimp, and a potential predator maybe coming up from behind.
Well, I think they're a more intelligent fish, and they have that ability to kind of stay still in the water column. So they use those pectoral fins to kind of keep themselves in the water. So it looks like they're kind of floating in space. And they have those two eyes that rotate independently so they can look forward and they'll kind of look at you and stay still. That look becomes very enchanting, you know?
We're gonna head into the world's only paternity ward. One of these seahorses has a pouch. Who has the pouch? The male, right?
When we bring a pair or two seahorses in from the wild, if you separate them, they die very quickly. So they're obviously stressed from, they don't want to be separated from the one that they're with.
So what happens every day in the seahorse world is one of the most beautiful mating dances in the animal kingdom. What they do is they intertwine those tails, they touch belly to belly, and they look directly into each other's eyes, and they start to dance vertically in the water column.
What I call it is biological synchronization. It seems like they get synchronized with another animal, and a male with a female, and they're ready at the same time. She's got her eggs ready, he's ready to receive her eggs, so she deposits her eggs into his pouch.
And the male has a final move, and what he does is he fills that pouch with water, and she will pass her eggs into his pouch. He will close up his pouch and fertilize the eggs internally. So now he is a pregnant male.
I have seen one female keep 6 or 7 males pregnant, which is pretty amazing.
He's got 650 babies in his pouch. How long do you think it takes him to give birth? Any guesses?
Not very long.
Not very long, about 2 minutes, okay? How long do you think she gives him to rest before she reimpregnates him with another batch of eggs? Not long. About 2 more minutes. So it's kind of like, you know, revenge of the ladies.
You see a lot of personalities, and especially with the breeders, and they live a long time. You know, we have animals that are 12 years old. So when they retire from the breeding area, and we move them into the holding area where we get to hold them and people can allow their tails to be wrapped around their finger, then you get to know them even more. And so we all notice that some of them have very different personalities from others.
What I want you to do is do high five for a second. Just kind of raise your hands up. And I want you to connect to your fingertips, okay? With your thumbs far apart. And you're gonna put this coral reef down into the water. And we're gonna come and wrap a seahorse's tail around your finger.
I name all my seahorses in my tank that I use for holding, and almost everybody else does in the farm. I mean, everybody gets attached to them, and there's certain ones that are special because of their color and their behavior. And some of them like to be in the front finger, some of them like to be in the back finger. Some of them like big fingers, some of them like little fingers. Some of them are sensitive to certain people they don't like. Sometimes they'll just turn and swim and that's it. They're booking. They're not gonna sit on that person's hands. And other people, they're happy to stay. And they have a way of communicating with each other in the tank. So if one of the animals in the group gets disturbed, that seahorse will kind of swim fast down to the group. And then the whole group will start moving.
What we do at the end of our tour, where our guests have the opportunity for seahorses to hold onto their hands, that all came from observing our children. They would walk around the farm with their little footstools and get up onto the tanks and put their fingers in their hands in the tanks, and the seahorses would come and hold onto their fingers.
For a lot of people, it's quite an emotional experience because it's such a connection with an animal in the ocean. You know, whales, everybody connects with, but they're kind of far away, kind of hard to get close to, but the seahorse right there in your hand, looking in their eyes, you know, is really pretty special.
I think it's completely admirable. Like, I don't know, I feel like so many, kind of like our tour guide was talking about, our mentality is always take, take, take. Like, especially because underwater, people can relate less to animals. Like, nobody cares as much about saving the bluefin tuna as like the tiger, you know, that you can see on land.
Well, I think it's amazing because because she's saving animals' lives.
Well, we would like to be able to be breeding many more species and have them on the marketplace, because that's how you really turn off the collection of wild fish. You breed them, they're there, people can make a choice, and they will choose a farm-raised pet over one that comes out of the wild.
The more yellow ones there are what we call sunbursts, and the browny-colored ones are the mustangs.
Once they understand that it's coming off the beautiful reefs in Hawaii, and they start to get the political pressure that people don't like that, and when they buy the fish and it lives a lot longer, they'll be happy to make the switch. That takes a lot of work and a lot of money because it's challenging. It's not easy to do. They're not guppies.
Seahorses are quite sedentary animals. They're not swimming around. They're not producing a lot of waste or consuming a lot of oxygen. So there they are, all nice and safe. This box is going to New York City, so it's Wednesday here. It'll get there Friday morning.
This is their dream, to help start saving an endangered species, to do something for the world that nobody else has done.
So it's a very small operation. The dog is Buck. Buck, yeah.
Now, you probably already heard that we have fished about 90% of the fish out of our oceans in the past 50 years. So the question becomes, how long will that last 10% last us as a human population?
The orange fencing in the tanks, we call a hitching post. And it's just a makeshift coral, something for them to wrap around and hang on to like they would to the coral in the ocean.
The seahorses are a good indicator species because they're depending on the bottom of the food chain. If they cannot survive, if their food source isn't out there, if there's no plankton, if there's no copepods, they're not going to survive. That means we can't survive.
Craig and Carol are kind of this synthesis of practical knowledge, drive, and just an unbelievable kind of entrepreneurial spirit in terms of pushing things into pretty uncharted territories.
It was very hard going in the early days, but it was a matter of conviction. We decided that we're going to do it, and we just went ahead with it. Quit our jobs, financed it ourselves, bought all the equipment.
This is what we started with. It was an old container, and the state of Hawaii rented us this little space, and they said, you know, go figure it out, you know? It was just a mess. I mean, we were just going to get electricity, and then we had to paint. We really didn't have very much money, because we just started the farm on our life savings.
If we had gone to, a bank or, a venture capitalist and said, this is what I want to do, they would probably say, you're crazy. You're never going to make it. And how am I going to get my money back?
We packed up the house, left, came out here. So we ate burritos for a year.
I remember one day we were driving by one of the other neighbor farms, and they had a bunch of old tanks sitting outside. And I said, Craig, stop the car. I'm going to go ask them if they'll give us those tanks. He's like, why would they do that? And I said, I don't know. They're just sitting there. So I jumped out of the car. I ran in there. And they said, oh, we'd love for you to take these tanks. They've been sitting here forever. And that was our hatchery.
So I used to go to people's trash bins and get their old pipe and then glue it together. But, a few years down the road, I was able to buy a real new pipe.
Swimming in the morning is my moment of meditation. It clears out the background noise, and it allows me to focus on my priorities for the day. And while I'm swimming, the first things I think about is, keep my children safe. And then the second thing I think is, keep our family, safe and happy, and our farm, protect our farm.
The school is a long way away, so normally one of us will take the children to school.
But we pretty much split up the responsibilities, and we usually fight about it. Who's gonna take the kids to school? Who's gonna pick them up?
We got together, parents, decided to hire a teacher and do our little school, and there's our schoolhouse.
I believe that children come to us, with a mission. I believe they pick their parents, and there's obviously a reason why they are here. And so the exposure to the marine environment, to the seahorses, to what we do, I think is appropriate.
I used to cry when I left the boys, but not anymore.
Well, that's my
this one
hair.
Right there?
Yeah.
Okay. How about, is it this one, the one that has the pouch?
Yeah.
So the educational component is big. It's a big part of what we do.
They each have their own pair of seahorses. And they have to clean their tanks and feed them. And they get to hold them in their hands when they're done. And what does it use the gills for? To get what out of the water?
Oxygen.
And the kids love bringing their friends because they feel proud. And I think it's an opportunity for them to connect with the ocean and ocean conservation. They know practically the whole script for the tour.
When we started the farm, we decided that we should help the coral reefs.
And if the coral doesn't live, the ocean doesn't live.
So we're hopeful that they will, you know, take on our mission at some point. I think they already have. You know, it's a farm. There's the routine of the day, you know, which is fast here. It's very fast because you've got so much time to get the feed ready, get the animals fed, and they eat, you know, all day long, it seems.
Did you do the juveniles?
Yes, I fed them. It looked like there was a little bit of food in there still, though, so I didn't feed them too much.
The feeding is the most critical part of the seahorse farm. In particular, from a certain age, from 30 to 60 days, that's where it's they're the most delicate, and food preparation and the application of the food is most critical.
So this is our team here. This is going to be their first food. So I'm going to put a little bit in here because they don't usually eat much on their first feed. You can see in here, probably about 200 babies.
So they would have been born around 7 o'clock this morning.
I love my mornings, you know, going around feeding the different animals, and I get a lot of enjoyment out of watching the animals spawn, seeing the eggs hatch or the live seahorses born, watching them, you know, grow up and breed again. And I love that whole process of domestication. As you go year by year, you start to see the results of that breeding program. So if you feed them too much, the food will come out the other end still swimming, because they don't have a proper stomach to store food. If you underfeed them, they die from starvation. You have to calculate in your mind, using all the science you have, to feed them the right amount, but you also have to use a feeling like, I think they're full. I was employed to run a shrimp hatchery, Molokai, and some of my co-workers were friends with Clyde. When I was over there working in the shrimp hatchery, yeah. And we had mutual friends that were working there.
I've known her for, before she got married, in fact.
And so we just became friends. And I think you went to Oceanic Institute.
Right. I gave her my card, I remember. So when you come, look me up. And then sure enough, she pops up in Hawaii. I go, oh my God, she's here. The risk that they're taking, you know, is extraordinary.
I think you told me you guys putting up everything that you had, right?
Yep.
So it's like rolling the dice and, you know, here you go. Oh my God.
The long-term impact is tremendous because she's raising awareness of the plight of the seahorse. And that's actually, if you use that as like the model for a lot of what's happening in the marine world because of the overfishing that's taking place globally. If you take a look at what China will become. And right now, as I said, her middle class is growing at a rate that pretty soon, she's still a net exporter, but pretty soon she will become a net importer. And that country is so huge. People don't understand how large that country is. And like I said, then they're gonna be hungry. If you think demand is gonna go away, no, it's not. I mean, people have to face that fact. It's not. It's like a sliding scale. For example, when my father was growing up, and then we had plenty of fish. And then when I grew up, I said, oh, we got plenty of fish. But it's a lot less than what my dad had. But I don't see that. I still think that we have plenty of fish. We have to raise this awareness so that everybody understands that this is a challenge that's facing. And then it's not just seahorses. You know, all of the tunas, I mean, all of the food fishes. I mean, it's pretty sad what's happening. We're at a point where we said, well, we got to stop this. And I think we're there. people really realize we're in trouble. As far as the aquarium trade, the big problem is, like I said, is one of these things about demand. And the Chinese still believe that it has medicinal properties. Maybe it does, I don't know. You tried?
The seahorse was the main herb put in all the teas. It was thought to increase the heat in the body, the yang. And that also can be, you know, interpreted as, you know, sexual dysfunction, you know, circulatory problems, heart disease, you know, a whole bunch of stuff. So they always put a seahorse in the tea. And there were plenty of them in the ocean, so who cared, right? I mean, that's how they thought, until they were all gone.
The amount they take is staggering.
Before they became an endangered species, traffic estimated the number at 50 million
50
per year.
Million
and that was
year.
By going over and counting.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it wasn't just a made-up number.
The big problem right now is because they're endangered. They've been fished, you know, almost to extinction. So you're gonna have to start doing some drastic measures.
It starts in that bottle right there.
No one had ever done it, no one knew it. And we had some expertise on what we thought was right,
yeah.
But we still had to do trials and see if it actually worked.
Yeah, tetrasomias, isoprasis, anyway, a variety of different kinds of phytoplankton. That's the basis of the food here.
Well, this is the foundation of our work, really. You know, it starts with the phytoplankton, and then the phytoplankton gets fed to the copepod. The copepod can get fed to the first day old fish larvae.
At the time, there was nobody doing that at all, so it was kind of new.
And it was very hard to find somebody that would be willing to test it, that knew how the food for those nutritional profile.
You needed a biochemist to do that kind of work.
So you got to harvest a lot, and you got to rinse it, you got to freeze it, then you got to get it to him. And then he's got to do whatever it is that he does, which he always tells me, I've got no idea how complicated it is. And then I sit there and wait for the report, you know, what's it going to say? Well, there's 36 species in the genus Hippocampus, and they're all endangered. And we have here in the farm between 20 and 26.
So this is basically part of our living gene bank on the farm. We have over half of the world's species of seahorses right here in this room. They're all breeding populations. If you go around the room, it's kind of like going around the world.
Come right on in. And what I want to show you first as you come in is the world's largest species of seahorse. And they are from California.
Hippocampus ingens. And they used to be common from Galapagos all the way up the West Coast, for sure as far north as San Diego. That seahorse is a very, very large seahorse. It's the largest in the world. Gets to be over a foot. They were one of the seahorses taken off for medicine, for sure. And within a very short period of time in Ecuador, they were gone. No one could find any seahorses. Are they making a comeback? You know, I don't know.
These are some of the pipefish babies that we've bred here. These are from the Great Barrier Reef.
And this pair here is from Hawaii. And they're hiding back there like they're supposed to do. The story of that seahorse is kind of interesting. They were recently rediscovered by homeless people in Alawai Canal, Waikiki. At low tide, they saw some seahorses, so they got a long-handled net and they pulled them up out of the water, put them in a bucket, and they went to the pet store to sell them. We heard about it, so we got some. And when they gave birth, I noticed that the babies were something I'd never seen before, so I thought they were a new species. It turns out there was another species identified in 1901 from Hilo Bay with the same profile, same genetic profile. So they were named a new species, Hippocampus helonus, I believe, last year. And they're very rare today in Hawaii, very rare.
Although this is a small aquarium, it is probably the world's only completely sustainable aquarium. In other words, everything in here is farm-raised. And most public aquariums have about a close to a 90% display rate of wild caught fish.
Now on this side of the room, all these animals are seahorses that you would find in the Caribbean or on the East Coast. Now the most delicate one is down here on that end, the tiny little pygmy seahorse. You guys see him? They have been struggling to survive.
There's a pygmy seahorse, Hippocampus zoroastri. They should be common all the way down the Florida Keys and back up the other side to the Mississippi, but they're not. And that's
for obvious reasons, the pollution. We were actually contacted by several organizations, news agencies, asking if we could restock these animals in that area. And I said, of course, but first they have to clean it up.
Anybody want to guess how many pet fish are taken off our reefs here in Hawaii per year? Hate to think about it. 2 to 10 million is the estimate.
When you hear figures like that, you just can't visualize it until somebody gives you a number, and then it's usually staggering, and then it's such a great number that it's overwhelming.
Now, how many do you think are taken off our Great Barrier Reef in Australia every year? How many do you think they allow?
Probably, yeah.
200,000, period.
Australia legislates very heavily and protects their natural resources very well. Over the length of the Great Barrier Reef, which is considerably larger than anywhere here in Hawaii, the fishing collectors have to notify authorities before they go out what they're going to be targeting, and then they report their catch when they return to the dock.
You can legally still collect a seahorse with a $15 permit in Hawaii if you find one. It's not illegal. On a federal level, it's definitely enforced, but the states have rights to their water up to 3 miles out, so the states have to one by one agree to protect the seahorse. So people have to be really aware and conscious of the fact that we need to leave these animals in the water when you see them.
I think people have finally realized that they have to take such stringent steps like Australia has done. You know, it's almost like they become isolationists, but I think what they're doing is they made up a mind that says, we want to protect our resources. This is what's going to take, and so we are going to do it. And that's what, you know, Hawaii is going to have to do as well, and the rest of the country.
I believe we need to make the Hawaiian reefs basically like a national monument. Just protect them 100%. Leave everything alone. Just come right on over, folks. We're going to gather around these three tanks here for a couple minutes. Now, my favorite animal in the animal kingdom is something called a leafy sea dragon. Has anyone ever seen one of those?
The leafy sea dragons are kind of like the holy grail of aquaculture. They have never been bred in captivity. They're almost gone in the wild. No one knows much about them. They're worth a fortune, you know, $15,000, $20,000 a piece. They're beautiful. What happens is the person who has the permit to get one pregnant male once a year out of the ocean, and that one pregnant male usually has 50 or 60 eggs on his tail. And when those hatch into live baby dragons, he will feed them live baby shrimp for about 3 months, and then he'll sell them to the public aquariums. We all know that we've got to do better than that, that we've got to, you know, leave the animals in the wild and produce them in captivity. My first life experience with seahorses was when I was a child, and my father would order them out of the back of a magazine, and they would come from Florida, and they were the tiny little pygmy seahorses. We would put them in our aquarium, which was a freshwater aquarium. We didn't know they were saltwater, and they wouldn't live very long. So I always had that memory as a kid, those little seahorses. We grew up on the shores of Lake Erie. My father had a house right on the beach. And Lake Erie looks like an ocean. I think it's about 60 miles long and 30 miles wide, so it's a huge body of water. And I remember as a kid, one of my jobs was to pick up the dead fish and bury them in a hole. And there was a lot of dead fish every morning. And I remember the water being green a lot, being dirty, like you couldn't see your feet.
The complexity of all pollution problems is exemplified by Lake Erie. It involves 25 polluted rivers and the sewage of 9 million people, 118 towns and 146 industries, in five U.S. states and one Canadian province.
My dad was Italian, and his father immigrated over with a whole bunch of buddies. I remember as a kid a lot of them dying from different types of cancer, and I started to think that maybe it was related to the pollution in the lake. And that, of course, was the time when the Cuyahoga River caught on fire. And so I felt like I wanted to get away from the lake because it was just a toxic environment. And I think that's where my passion came from, to clean up the waterways. When Craig came into my life, he thought it was great what I was doing. He was very supportive. I was on a mission to, you know, get out of school with a science degree and get involved in aquaculture. So I was fortunate enough to be able to take a trip to Galapagos when I was in my first year of college. And I ran into some friends of mine who were the first shrimp farmers. And they were setting up a hatchery along the coast of Ecuador.
We met in Ecuador in 1988,
I was backpacking around South America and a mutual friend introduced us. I was on a round the world trip, but I only got halfway.
That was a time in Ecuador where you would walk down the street and you would run into somebody selling you anything from, you know, a macaw to a crocodile to a wild cat. You know, it was a time where you'd go to the Amazon and it would be beautiful and you'd come back 6 months later, it would be gone. I mean, it was just a wipeout going on. And little by little, you know, we started dropping out of the shrimp hatchery industry because a lot of us started to feel bad about that. Like we were part of the problem rather than the solution. When I saw the seahorses being taken out, it was probably the third year that I was in Ecuador. You'd watch the fishermen bring up the shrimp and then they'd bring up another bucket and that would be the seahorses. And they would go to this guy who would take them out of the water and put them in his like bag. So he wasn't taking them alive. And then after about 6 months, the seahorses were just gone. They weren't there anymore. So I realized that this was another resource extraction done in a kind of quiet, secretive way.
Anybody who's been to Maui is familiar with Molokini. It's a horseshoe-shaped crater with a bowl in the center. It's very popular for boats to go to snorkel. And I went there every day, and I gotta say, it was my job. I'm talking 25 years ago. It was my job to lead the tourists around, and it was the only hour in the day when I felt at peace and I felt happy. And, you know, people might think that it's a little bit airy-fairy to think that that was Hawaii giving me my role here, but I think it was.
Snorkel Bob clearly loves ocean, loves the reefs, and he has seen a lot of devastation to the reefs by collectors taking out large numbers of reef fish. He's kind of the leader of this movement. He takes it very seriously. He's done a lot of research. He's created bills, and he's gone to the legislators, and he is determined to get these bills passed to close down the taking of wild reef fish off our coral reefs here in Hawaii.
The most soulful insult is the Hawaiian cleaner wrasse. He is endemic. And the Hawaiian cleaner wrasse picks parasites from the skins and scales of other species of fish. Without the cleaner wrasse, a reef is exposed to parasite infestation. There is no limit on the catch. They ship out from Hawaii every day by the hundreds. They will die of starvation in 30 days unless they have 30 other fish to clean. And I was in this warehouse and I saw in several tanks there were Hawaiian cleaner wrasse. And I said, "You have Hawaii cleaner wrasse?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "They're gonna die." He said, "They're fun."
This morning, I went for a swim out here, my local spot here in front of the farm. And when I go in the water out there, I want to see my fish, you know, because I know all the fish. They're always the same fish, and same places pretty much. And this little tiny boat pulled up right where the pyramid butterflies are. And I thought, they better not be a collector. And so I was going to go get them. I was gonna go swim right up to them and make sure they weren't getting in the water collecting my fish, you know. And when I came closer to them, they kind of waved and they turned and went away. And I was grateful, because I was gonna approach them. Remember I was telling you that story about Craig going diving one night here with a collector just to see what they did?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And they were going after these feather duster worms, and they would smash this whole coral. And it's still, and it's still legal to do it.
Right.
If it's properly documented that you were the direct demise of a coral head, I believe it's the fine's like $1,000 a coral head.
We met because I got that.
Yeah, it's important to have, you know, friends like that. You can just talk about what's going on. Yeah. The collectors go out at night in Kaneohe Bay, you know, with a hammer, just hammer the heck out of the coral and grab the feather duster, put it in his little bag, and off you go.
If I touch it, watch what happens to this guy.
There's a tube, he goes all the way inside.
So to collect him, you literally have to bust the coral head to get to it. And that's why you have this collateral damage. It's not just picking the one worm. That means like 73,000 pieces of coral have been destroyed just to get that thing out of it. So So we have developed at least a technology in which that we can close the cycle, we can produce them artificially.
It has to come from everybody saying this is what we want to do.
I really hope it doesn't come to violence around here concerning fish collecting. It wouldn't surprise me if it occasionally occurred.
There's about five huge wholesalers that control most of the marine trade coming in from Asia, distributed out to all the little pet stores around the United States. You walk through that warehouse, and it's huge. It's like two Walmarts, each one of these warehouses. I mean, they're doing the best they can to keep the animals healthy, but the fact is it's all recirculating water, so if one animal has a disease, they're all gonna get it. And a lot of those fish don't live very long. They just don't.
My friend Luciano, who's actually a collector here, one of the big collectors, you know, he says the reason why Hawaii is so popular is because everywhere else people have eaten the fish. He's been all over the world collecting fish. He was like one of the first guys to do this.
He is a wealth of knowledge about the fish. He knows their natural history, their biology, their spawning, all that stuff. So he's a valuable person to have working with us.
I was interested in fish, they told me, since I started talking. I just think the various pressure groups that are against fish collecting are swaying the politician because, you know, it's an emotional issue. Nobody wants to see the little fish being taken and put in an aquarium. My customers are ready tomorrow to buy tank-raised fish of any kind.
If you sold me, say, I don't know, 20 of the little tanks, and then they would grow out in my system, so they would be, you know, kind of adapting
to your environment,
yeah,
and food and so on and so forth.
So they wouldn't be so stressed coming out of the ocean as a large breeder already.
Right.
Well, we have those two tall tanks in the back.
Right.
Remember those way in the back?
Yeah.
Those are
empty.
Couple weeks, be yellow tank.
When it comes to captive breeding in general, I have very severe misgivings. My fear is it would greenwash the hobby, and it would make people think, here's a good conservation-based hobby I can get into. Instead of 1.5 million, the number of tanks will grow to 2 million, 3 million.
He does not believe people should have aquariums. I don't agree with that. And I think it's also an opportunity to educate people about the marine environment. If they have the animal in their home aquarium, they might start to think about saving the coral reefs. If they have no connection with those animals at all, they're not going to care.
I've been a career scuba instructor for the 20 years I've been here. About 5 years ago, I got into aquarium fishing. People today still come to Hawaii because they saw a fish in an aquarium, a Hawaiian yellow tang or whatever, in an aquarium. So, wow, wouldn't it be nice to go there and actually swim with them in the wild? I think the aquarium industry helps promote tourism here in Hawaii and actually is a good thing.
My business is I set up beautiful tanks for people and I take care of the tanks.
The yellow tang is specific out of Hawaii. The hippo tang, the blue tang, it's also called the royal tang, that comes out of the Philippines, all around Indonesia. Now, unfortunately, they have been using cyanide to catch a lot of these fish, say like the hippo tanks, and they're able to get the fish out of the reef a lot easier and put them into the nets, and then they snap out of it. But what happens is, if they've ingested too much cyanide, these fish only last a couple of weeks. Maybe 3-4 weeks tops. They'll look perfect. You'll buy them in a store, put them in your tank in a few days or a week or so, they just die.
Most developing countries will not say no to easy dollars. Dollars are gonna be the death of nature. We know this.
The collectors are trying to sell us in the notion that that having half as many or a third as many fish in those reef areas is okay. We were just doing research for our books, and we would go out and work our way around the Hawaiian Islands to basically all the snorkeling spots. We could see differences in the populations between the areas that are protected and are not protected. It seemed to us that compared with some other areas, Hawaii's fish populations are relatively low, and we wondered why.
We had a meeting in Maui, this is a few years ago now, and an aquarium collector showed up and he said, you know, you guys say there's no yellow tangs. You just don't know where to go. Ukamehame. is a reef on central Maui, and it's probably, again, I'm guessing 100 acres of finger coral, prime habitat for yellow tang. He said, I was at Ukamehame, and there's a little known behavior where yellow tangs come in shallow in the day, and they perform their work, their reef function, which is to graze algae. At night, they go deep to slumber. And sometimes there's a social behavior where they'll make a vertical wall. It's deep and it's not that fat, and it's lots of yellow tangs in there. And he says, I can go out there to the yellow tang wall at dusk, a couple miles out on Ukamehame. I drop my net down one side and up the other. I can catch 400 tangs in 10 minutes. And I'm here to tell you, it's a thing of beauty. If I give them the benefit of the doubt, I say they're in it for the money.
A lot of media printed otherwise tend to like the headline and tend to side with the sensational as opposed to the facts or the reality. We're definitely reticent typically to deal with the media. Just for the track record, I mean, we never get a fair shake.
Initially, when I knew we were going to do the interview, I wasn't sure about doing it because I'm sure you've heard the term reef raper. You know, people call us reef rapers. We're taking all these beautiful fish and corals off the reef, so I didn't want to have a finger or many fingers pointed at me. Then I thought it through again and realized, well, there's a lot to say about it on both sides.
To me, it's amazing that if they can't protect the seahorse, when the seahorse is obviously, it is an endangered species, most of the world protects the seahorse. How can you believe them when they say that the other fish that are taken out of the ocean aren't endangered?
These oceans and these fish belong to everybody. Well, if they belong to everybody, how can one set of people decide to take them?
I think it's a little bit like ivory. If you have a commodity, people will buy it. What you have to do in a place like Hawaii is say, no, you can't have our fish.
Besides the 35% that is off limit to the collecting, 15% is already long time no take area completely. So half the coastline is closed.
Cumulative trauma kills most of these fish. They herd them into a net, that's traumatic. They grab them by hand, that's trauma too.
Then you're taking this animal, and so that it doesn't, you know, cut any of the other animals or cut the bag open that it's inside of, their scalpels are cut. Their swim bladder is punctured with a needle so that it can off-gas.
Once caught, fish and invertebrates are placed in plastic containers or bags. To unnaturally ease the pressure that builds up inside of fish when they are brought to the surface, collectors pierce the fish's air bladder with a hypodermic needle. Once ashore, fish and invertebrates are placed in holding tanks, where they are then packaged for transport and export.
I suppose some people might think or assume that we catch fish a way that is different from the way we actually catch them. From what we can gather, from what we know, and from what magazines, you know, a recent issue, I think Coral Magazine talks about how we're a model. We're a world model for how to collect tropical fish.
Our reefs are in decline, and they're taking fish from the reefs in the millions.
Yellow tangs, I think, are maybe only averaging about 350,000 a year statewide. So yeah, these 10, 9, and 10 million figures are purely sensational just to, you know, bring attention to their plight.
Maui has come down on the business of the aquarium trade. Wait a second, this is about money. Maui County has done what it can to make this less profitable in Maui County. Hallelujah, I'm proud to be from a place like that.
Every legislative session, there's some bill that wants to ban aquarium collecting. Oddly enough, it hasn't happened yet, I wonder why. Maybe because they're really, when the story is told, and the legislators are made aware of the facts, they realize, hey, you know, a ban is a bit of an overreaction to the situation.
There can never be a middle ground reached because the collectors as a group aren't willing to compromise. Their position is, we'll do whatever we want, leave us alone. There is a problem, and people are mad as hell about it.
What's being discussed at this hearing is whether people will support the various issues that are all included in the one, what we call the rules package. And there are several. There's a ban on scuba spearfishing. There is the white list. There is the new fish replenishment area at Kauai Bay. There is no take on 9 species of sharks and rays, as well as 2 very valuable shells that keep the coral healthy.
In 1998, the West Hawaii community made it abundantly clear to me, as the state representative for North Kona and South Kohala, that long-term sustainability of its nearshore marine resources was a top priority.
Aloha, everybody, and thank you for coming tonight. My name is Tina Owens, and I have lived in Kona for 20 years.
Until 1998, it had gotten more and more vociferous, and people had gotten more and more angry because the fish were, noticeably being depleted. You could go on dives and just hardly see any of the colorful fish. The state just was not going to do anything about it. And so Lost Fish got together, and we tried to get a ban on the aquarium collecting industry, but we realized pretty quickly that the state's not going to ban an entire industry, especially if it's a fisheries that can be managed. They're not going to put all these people out of business, and we're in a recession. They're not going to do this just because people say, I don't like it.
Now, the killiecake are having some problems, and they need to be protected even more than I think than is on this rule package. I'm sure everyone in this room is aware that the aquarium fishery in West Hawaii is under attack, spearheaded by Maui ecologists. It is my hope that true fishery science will prevail.
Hi, my name is Leonard Teresa. I am against the 40 species whitelist in terms of banning spearfishing with scuba. Don't ban and stop local people from feeding their families.
I have dived here for over 2 decades and have observed a decline in larger individuals of certain species like parrotfish, jacks, and wrasses. It's not science, but it's probably not coincidence either. I have seen scuba spearfishing up close and can say that recreationally speaking, it is not a sport, but rather a slaughter, especially at night when some fish are asleep. Almost everyone else in the world seems to have figured this out. Hawaii is one of the few places left that have not already banned spearfishing with scuba, and we need to remedy that.
The global fishery situation has been known for over 2 decades that the decline has been taking place. The demand for fish is still increasing. So all they're gonna do is go someplace else and go get more fish. That's why aquaculture right now is the fastest growing segment in agriculture in the world, not just in Hawaii, in the nation, but in the whole world. Aquaculture can provide a significant impact in the short term, but you have to actually find other alternatives. So you're gonna have to look at grain alternatives for protein. It's going to be a really collaborative effort to overcome the population's desire for seafood products.
I said to Craig the other day, I said, we really are going to have to start doing this. We're going to have to start getting yellow tangs in here. We're going to have to start getting more angelfish. The community is expecting us to do it. So suddenly it's not us setting the bar. It's other people setting the bar. And I couldn't be happier with the relationship with Luciano because he is helping us. He's giving us points about their natural history and their spawning habits, stuff that, we didn't know. And nobody else knows either, certainly not in any book.
Scientists today believe that if we can put 20% of our oceans into marine protected areas, that marine life will come back. So where do you start with that? Where I'd like to start, besides my own backyard, is Tonga. When I went to Tonga last fall with the boys' Hawaiian teacher, who happens to be part Tongan, and we were able to actually see firsthand what's going on there, I realized that it was an opportunity for us to help and make a difference. So who set up the lab in the beginning?
Well, in the beginning, we have a lab. It's part of Japanese government funding. And then we have another donor from EU. And you can see there's a lot of equipment around here. And some of the equipment, I don't know how to use it.
Yeah.
Never saw it before. It is funny,
Yeah. And what other species do you think are important to culture here?
Maybe like fish or sea cucumber. There's not an alternative because sea cucumber here in Tonga is very important.
Yeah, we were just recently in Fiji after we were in Ewaiki last September. And we went to their resorts, and the only place that we could go see a normal reef was on the reserves.
Yes.
So when you'd sign up for these, you know, expensive dives, that was the only place I could take you, because everywhere else, everything was gone.
So they're attached at the base, and again, they're about probably 2 years old. Tridacna dorata. They're a giant clam. Clams are a pretty important food source for the locals when they can find them. So yeah, the whole purpose is to grow them up till they're a few inches, send them out, and then the locals will go and collect them.
So at 2 years, you think they're ready to restock, or you?
Yeah, I'd say anything over that, sort of getting this size.
Would I be able to purchase, say, 100 of the giant clam 2-year-olds to take with me to stock on the reef at Ewaiki?
Yeah, I think that idea would make a lot of sense, yeah.
When I was a child and we used to go back, you used to just walk on the reef and you could see all the clams, you know, just all over the reef. And then eventually as I started to go back and you notice maybe 2 or 3 in an area and swim along, and then now you can see one every 100 yards.
The owner of one of the islands, it's called Treasure Island, or Ewaiki Resort, his name is Mark Belvedere. They're very, very angry with the poachers who are coming there and taking, at night, they go to their island, which they actually own. They go in there with lights and they take the sea cucumbers and the giant clams and the clownfish.
On our last visit to Tonga, I found out that they're tropical fishing and being shipped out to China and by the plane loads.
This is probably the greatest sailing culture with the greatest untold story in maritime history. What you're really looking at is the largest canoe in the world.
How long is the vessel?
108 feet, actually. But nevertheless, today, they don't utilize this type of sailing craft. They have taken the modern vessels. A gallon of gas is your day's wage almost. So what they're doing is fishing the reef directly in front of their village or their town, and they're overfishing it, and they're killing off that reef.
The proud father.
This is, yeah, we're gonna make all of these grow.
And when you were a little girl, what were the reefs like? Were there a lot of seahorses and a lot of fish, a lot of coral?
Yeah. Yeah, she said this time there is some, but the old time there are plenty of seahorses.
And what about fish and giant clams?
Yes, she said it's the same. Yeah.
And the giant clam is an endangered species on Appendix 2, just like seahorses and corals. So it is officially protected by almost all the countries of the world. It really is an important animal. It's part of a healthy ecosystem of a reef, and it really should be there. So hopefully we can start to bring it back.
It'll show the rest of the islanders how it could be, you know. It'll be a nice little food source for the island as well.
Okay, Carol, if you look, here we are, this is Ewaiki.
Where?
Ewaiki.
This is Tonga. And Tonga gets this reef here. This is Ovaka, and Ovaka has all of this. Nuapapu has the most people, but yet has no reef. These guys have no food source.
You mean over here?
Yeah. It's too far for them to grow.
Jump in. We're gonna go look at a reef that has been overfished by the village.
Get over here.
Woo! It looks like a bomb went off. There's hardly any vertebrates, hardly any coral, no big fish at all.
There's some juvenile fish that have been probably spawned at a nearby reef and have just come in trying to settle. It's going to take 15 years for that reef to come back. There's some islands close by with a lot of villagers that, you know, go to the reef for food every day. And my assumption would be that they've gone there and just taken all the food. At some point, there's going to be nowhere to go. It's going to cost them a lot of gas money to get out to other reefs that are further away. And to find a solution.
It was sad for us to go to these little isolated islands and not see any fish. Being a sustenance fisherman, when money came into the deal, you know, you don't fish for just you and your family. Now you fish to get as much as you can to make money, to pay for bills and do everything else. It changes the whole perspective on surviving off the ocean. It's more surviving of what you can make off of the ocean.
And I think the other side of the spectrum too, where people say, well, just don't eat any fish at all, is another cop-out. It's basically saying, you know, just leave the ocean alone, don't worry about it anymore, because I'm not eating fish. So I think if people eat seafood, then they're going to be more apt to get involved in where it's coming from, and how healthy is it, and what can I do so we can have more seafood. And it's not just seafood, but it's also the beautiful fish on the coral reefs.
Nunia, who's from the island here of Tonga, and it's a village of how many families, Nunia?
There's 12 family.
Since you were a little girl fishing the reef to now, how much volume of fish and clam and everything is it gone? It must have gone down, or?
Yeah, it's different from old days right now.
Would you say half or less, or?
Half, I think half.
So when do you remember it twice as much? How long ago?
30 years, I think it's better.
In the old days, you didn't have the fancy spear gun.
Yeah.
And so now they have the spear gun, and they have better ways to catch the fish, and it's still half the fish they come back with.
Yeah.
So, and even though they have technology to get the fish much easier, still it's about half of what you used to get, even with that technology. How much did they pay the people for the sea cucumber?
They use a leader for 25 ba'anga.
25 pa'anga is equal to about $15. And how long it take you to fill the bucket?
Maybe 2 days or 3 days.
2 to 3 days to fill the bucket?
We know it's not fair. Yeah, sometimes they get angry, but every day they need money for their family.
Which color is the most expensive one?
The white one.
And is it, how big?
Look, the size, maybe half of the size.
You know how much they get for that? She says only $1 each.
How old do you think this guy is? 35 years? $1, it's a pity. They're like a pet, you know? I mean, they're beautiful. Look at the colors. 10 of these in a day, one person gets, you know. It's beautiful. How long can they last? It's a 30-year-old animal. It's outrageous. Where we're going now is a reserve, but I understand where nobody is allowed to take anything off of. It's not just a reserve for the island, it's a reserve for everybody. It's called the Coral Gardens. And it's an area where tourists come. And they go on the whale watching boats. They always come by here, look at the caves, and come here. Garden, so obviously very valuable reserve for the Tongan tourist industry.
And for the Tonganese people, it's beneficial to them because ecotourism is on the rise. And if they can bring more tourists in to see those reefs that are protected, that'll be full of fish and life, it'll be good for them. It's an alternative to poaching it and selling it once, and then it's gone forever.
The decision on whether or not to have an aquarium or a terrarium or a planter, it all comes down to personal. This is a living thing. I think that wildlife should not be kept in captivity, period. That's my take. If you go anywhere and you see an aquarium, they need to know this is not casual. This is not ornamentation. This is not harmless, it's harmful. Stand up, step up, speak up. If you just keep watching it go down, it will just continue to go down. It's okay if we fail, as long as we try.
Carol is doing a fantastic program with the seahorses, helping keep the seahorses from being overexploited. And they're so easy to collect that really puts them at a danger, much more than any other fish that I would know. So it's great that Carol and Craig are the one holding the flag up for those poor little seahorses, right? Good luck, Carol. That's not an easy thing.
You have to raise awareness for the whole next generation. That's why, like, the stuff you're doing with your farm and teaching the young kids, that's the guys that you got to hit. Because they're the ones that are going to inherit all of this. So it's their, you know, they got to make those hard decisions. Raising awareness, that's the key. That's the key.
I think all species in the ocean are tied together in convoluted forms and oscillations. So I think that, you know, you take one block of that out of the equation and you're going to get an upset situation. There's many species of fish where the one that you see in the pet store is the one that's made it. There's probably all along down through the chain from the wholesaler all the way to the fishing village where it was caught, there's been a lot of the same specimen that didn't make it.
I feel that we're making a difference. And the reason I say that is because we have already changed the way the pet trade looks at farmed raised fish versus wild caught. They know now that you don't have to take fish out of the ocean. Doesn't mean it's stopped, but they know it's coming. And I know we're making a difference because when the visitors come through the farm on the tours and I ask them, how do you feel? And they tell me, you know, I'm amazed that you guys have been able to do this. And I feel like I have hope. And that means a great deal to me when they say they have hope. Who am I? Well, I guess I'm definitely an environmental warrior, having a lot of fun. The Seahorse Farm just always felt right. And I feel very lucky and very satisfied to be, you know, living my dream.
I think seeing that someone is able to start from nothing and build up based on their beliefs, it definitely inspires other people to do the same thing. And I think in the future we'll see a lot more environmentally friendly programs like this.
You can't depend on just donations and the goodwill of other people to keep things like this going. It's got to be something that is can support itself.
Whoever would have believed that seahorses could be domesticated? I mean, really. And that in itself is just a wonderful thing for the planet.
You know, we really liked the tour. We had no idea of the variety of the seahorses. And really how commonplace they were, even in some of our local waters, like down to the Keys. But what I love is, and what we were all real impressed with, was they didn't take any government grants, they didn't take any handouts, they wanted it to stay real independent so they could do it the way that they thought would breed the most success. We understand that the more we understand and the more we respect them, the more we'll be interested in keeping them going. So it was a great tour. We really enjoyed it.